Episode 1328, My Strength is My Story with O.S. Hawkins, The Nehemiah Code.
Moms, needing a little inspiration and a ray of hope? You've come to the right place. This is the show that you can turn to for just the pick-me-up you need. This is Create Your Now, Your Best Selfie. Here's your host, certified life coach, personal trainer, and nutritionist, Christiane Wargo. Staring at a
stop sign, watching. Happy, happy day. Today is my favorite day of the week. It is my Strength is My Story series, and we have a doctor in the house, Dr. O.S. Hawkins. I'm telling you right now, you're going to be blessed. It is time to fill your cup. Because you know what? It's never too late for a new beginning. For those of you who are brand new to Create Your Now, friends and family of Dr. Hawkins and Susie, welcome to our family. I'm so delighted of your presence. If you already haven't had the opportunity, you want to head on over to createyournow.com where you can learn more and sign up for the Kisses newsletter, the Keep It Simple Strategy, Everyday Solutions to Live, Love, and Impact. Have you ever woken up and you're like, gosh, if I could just have a fresh start? It's never too late for a new beginning. Maybe you're afraid to delegate and you're more into dictating and saying this is how it has to be done, or conflicts are just something that you don't want to deal with. If any of these ring a bell to you, which they probably do, unfortunately, because it's called life, you will be blessed with incredible nuggets. Get your pen and paper out. Be ready to get your cup filled up. Dr. Hawkins is bringing it all. And also, he shares a secret in the Nehemiah Code. And I just got to tell you, we have something in common. See what that secret is all about. So without further ado, let's welcome in Dr. O.S. Hawkins, the Nehemiah Code. Hello and welcome to Create Your Now. I am so excited. We have a doctor in the house. It's Dr. O.S. Hawkins. He is a husband of 48 years. To his beautiful wife, Susan, they have two daughters who are also married and six grandchildren. I believe his heart is very full. He has served pastorates, including the First Baptist Church in Fort Lauderdale, Florida, and the First Baptist Church in Dallas, Texas, for more than 25 years. Dr. Hawkins is the president and CEO of Guidestone Financial Resources, serving over 250,000 pastors, church staff members, missionaries, doctors, university professors, and other Christian organizations. He speaks regularly to business groups and churches across the nation. When Dr. Hawkins has a moment and extra energy, you will find him writing, as he's an author to over 40 books. You may recognize some of them: the Daniel Code, the Joshua Code, the James Code, the Jesus Code, the Believer's Code, and his brand new book, The Nehemiah Code. It's never too late for a new beginning. Welcome, my friend and brother in Christ. How are you, Dr. Hawkins?
Thank you, Christiane. I'm thrilled to be here, and thanks for mentioning my wife, Susie.
Oh, she's adorable. I kind of did a little snooping in the background, and you guys make an adorable couple.
Well, thank you. We're just awfully blessed. She's my rock and anchor for a lot of years, and she's got quite a ministry in her own right. She's been chairman of a global relief board. She's been all over the world many times the last few short years. She's an author herself, does a blog. She's very active in ministry.
Oh, well, I've got to ask you the question. What is it that, I mean, you've been married 48 years, that really makes a happy, working, loving marriage?
Oh, golly, you might have to ask her, because she, I think patience on her part, probably. You know, we've been blessed. We pastored some wonderful people for many, many years. I was pastor of First Baptist Church in Dallas, and 15 years First Baptist Church in Fort Lauderdale, and she was the consummate pastor's wife who loves people, and we've just been about loving people for a long, long time.
Oh, that's so important. Well, today, what brings joy to your heart?
Well, what brings joy to my heart is what's brought it joy to my heart every day since I was 17 years old and came to know Christ, and that is what Paul said, Christ in me, the hope of glory. I was 17 years old, had never heard a prayer in my home, never seen the Bible open in my home, could count on that hand how many times I'd ever been in a church. And that was midnight mass on Christmas Eve with cousins and aunts and uncles who were Catholic. Didn't know Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John were books of the Bible, and I grew up in Fort Worth, Texas. But a young man witnessed to me after a basketball game one night and my senior year. I thought he was crazy, but I couldn't get away from what he said. And he invited me to his church the next Sunday morning. I heard the gospel for the first time, and not what ought to be today, but I've never been the same since that morning.
Praise the Lord. And we are blessed with that redemption within you, because you have written a code series. I believe the Nehemiah Code is the 7th book in the series. What really drew you in and inspired you to start writing the code series?
Well, the first of all the royalties to all these books go to Mission Dignity. We'll talk about that in a moment. But we're on a mission to bring dignity here at Guidestone to some forgotten people, and that's pastors and their widows. Most of them are widows now, in their declining years, that they pastored out in the crossroads, had nothing, didn't have enough to eat on, much less prepare for retirement. And we have a program with them. 10 years ago, we were able to give them, and there are thousands of them in the program, give them $50 a month extra, which helped. But now the neediest, we've been able to raise so much money, the neediest get $600 a month. And one little widow of a pastor, 87 years old, wrote me the other day, and she said, I get to eat at night now, and it's not just a piece of toast. So anytime somebody buys one of the code books, every dime of the royalties all go to that. And there have been over right at 1.5 million of them sold in the last 3 or 4 years. So to answer your question, it began really with the Joshua Code. When I began to be concerned, you know, Joshua 1:8 says, this book of the law shall not depart out of your mouth, but you shall meditate on it day and night in order to do all that is written therein. Then you'll make your way prosperous, and then you'll have good success. So I began to see people coming to Christ, and the Bible was just such a big, thick book to them. They didn't know where to start. They start in Genesis, and they get bogged down by the time they get to Leviticus, or they start in Matthew, and there's those names they can't pronounce in the genealogy. So I decided there are 52 verses in the Bible that every believer ought to know. And so the Joshua Code is that, 52 scripture verses every believer should know. One a week for a year, you memorize one of those verses, their devotional helps there to them, and do it. So then we followed, that had such incredible success, sold several hundred thousand copies, that we followed that up with the Jesus Code, which is 52 scripture questions every believer ought to answer. You know, Jesus, in the Gospels, there are 150 questions recorded that escaped his lips. He was always asking questions. He wasn't needing answers. He was omniscient. He was trying to position ourselves. So I picked out 52 questions in the Bible that I think every believer ought to be able to answer before they get to heaven. And so it's a devotional book. You know, if a man dies, shall he live again? For example, there are all those. Jesus said, who do you say that I am? So then it just continued to go and continued to grow. And now the new one, as you mentioned, is the Nehemiah Code. And the real secret is that subtitle. It's never too late for a new beginning. You know, I've seen in life, as I've pastored and as I've lived and loved people for a lot, everybody's at some point in their life, most of us are looking for a new beginning. Maybe we lost a job. Maybe we went through a divorce. Maybe we lost a loved one to death. Maybe we lost some self-confidence. Maybe we had a misstep in our lives with sin. And we're looking for a new beginning. And so it's never too late, no matter who you are, where you're from, for a new beginning. That's really the message of Nehemiah.
And it's a strong message. Today, people are searching for that fresh start, like you mentioned. How can they begin rebuilding and that process?
The first step, the first section of the book, I talk about how Nehemiah got started right. You know, Nehemiah was not a pastor and he wasn't a prophet. He was a civil servant. He was the cupbearer to the king Artaxerxes back in Persia. And so he had a civil service job with retirement benefits. He was fixed for life. And yet he heard that report that the walls of Jerusalem after the Babylonian captivity were still broken down and the gates were still burned. And what was worse, he said, the people were a reproach to God. And so he left everything he had and he went back to Jerusalem to be the rebuilder of the broken walls, to have a new beginning for the people in Jerusalem. And so he got started right by making an honest evaluation. You know, I play golf, and I know a lot of your listeners are women, and a lot of ladies play golf now. But the most important shot in golf is the tee shot. It's getting started right. If you hit the ball over in the woods or you just dribble it off the tee, you're going to have a hard time. But if you hit the ball down the fairway where you position yourself to get the ball on the green for the next shot, that first shot is the most important one. And it's true in beginning. It's beginning, too, is getting started right. And so what Nehemiah tells us is the first thing we need to do is make an honest evaluation of the situation. Sometimes we're just not honest with ourselves, and it's always somebody else's fault, or this happened because of this, and so many times we don't make an honest evaluation of really what's going on. It's hard for us to do. And then what he did secondly was he identified with the need. He got over there, and he took a midnight ride around the walls, and he wept over the ruins, and he identified the need. Then he took personal responsibility. Nobody's going to have a new beginning unless we take some personal responsibility ourselves, and then he moved out of his comfort zone. It was all new to him, but he moved out of his comfort zone. And I think, Christiane, that one of our problems in life is today, we just live in little comfort zones. Some of them are economic. We don't have any dealings with anybody that's not in our economic strata, or social, or some of them are political. I mean, we'll get along with everybody as long as they have the same political views we do. So we all live in these little comfort zones, and the secret to rebuilding life is to move out of those comfort zones.
So true. We have to move out of those comfort zones. And I know as a mom and as a woman who owns a business, I mean, you're a CEO of a business, it takes a lot of effort. And unfortunately, sometimes we're always feeling like we're at the grindstone and we lose that motivation, we lose that inspiration, or we just get tired of pushing through. You write that Nehemiah was the master motivator. What does he teach us on how we can keep moving forward?
Well, he challenged his people to do four things. He challenged them to gird up, to get to work. He challenged them to team up. You know, synergy is so important. We all need each other. And, you know, the Bible says if one can chase 1,000, two can chase 10,000. So there's something synergistic about being, if I had a pencil, Christiane, a wooden pencil right now, I could break it very easily. But if I put two or three of them together, it's exponentially more hard to do. And so we need each other. And in rebuilding, we don't do it on our own. We need each other. And so he goes through all these processes related to that to show us how much that we're not living on an island somewhere isolated. We all need each other.
Amen. You all are going to want to pick up your own copy of the Nehemiah Code. It's never too late for a new beginning. Well, Dr. Hawkins, in your book, you break it down into six parts: getting started right, building a team. But in part three, you talk about chapter three in Nehemiah, where it seems like a lot of people, including pastors, one like yourself maybe, would gloss over that chapter, not even want to look at it. What did you mean when you said, let go without letting up?
See, that interesting, Christiane. You look at some commentaries by some, or devotional commentaries by some well-known authors that you and me and all your readers have read, and if you look at some of the stuff on Nehemiah, they completely don't even deal with chapter 3. But it's the secret of what he did, because when I talk about letting go without letting up, he's dealing with delegation there. Some people want to try to have a new beginning by being a dictator. They dictate things, or if they've got things around them. Some people abdicate. They just don't want to. They just keep procrastinating, putting it off. But delegating issues, if we're talking about a team and rebuilding as a church or rebuilding a business or something like that, then Nehemiah was the master delegator. He delegated things. He set clear objectives with specific tasks. He picked the right person for the right job. He was an example himself. And that's one of the most important things you can do if you're trying to rebuild a church or a business or a family or anything else, is to be an example yourself. The greatest principle, Christiane, I think that I know of leadership in the Bible, outside the Bible, anywhere, is over in the book of Judges, where it's said of Gideon, right? He pared his army down, if you remember, to 300 men, and he was going out to fight that thousands of the Midianite hosts. And right before they went out to battle, he turned around to his men in Judges 7, I think it's verse 7, and he looked at them and he said this, "Do as I do." That's the greatest principle of leadership I know, because basically I'm here at Guidestone and we have 460 people working in this building today, and they basically do as I do. I mean, if I drag in late, they do. If I don't, but so it's an important principle of leadership. And so that's why Nehemiah, that's why it's so important for us in the home to be an example ourselves. If we're a child, if we're a wife, if we're a husband, not to just always be abdicating that place of responsibility or dictating to someone else, but to be an example ourselves. It's amazing what one person can do to change the atmosphere of an entire home or a business, a church or anything. And that's really one of the real secrets of Nehemiah. The great secret really though is in the next chapter, because we all meet obstacles, and there he deals with how to overcome those obstacles, which is really important in life.
We have a lot of obstacles that create these kind of brick walls. Sometimes we just kind of stop. What would you say to the person who's stuck right now, whether it's in their marriage, in their business? They're like, okay, I know I need to be moving forward. I know I need to be doing something, rebuilding, but I don't know what to do.
First of all, deal with it head on. If you've got a boil on your arm and you just put salve on it, sometimes you have to lance it before it'll ever heal. And so you deal with these conflicts head on, and then you have to make some proper adjustments. I mean, that you have to make themselves just keep doing what is right. And, you know, conflict resolution is vitally important in the home or wherever it is. And a lot of people never get rebuilt because we're in conflict with each other. And, you know, when I grew up on the east side of Fort Worth, we had a vacant lot where all the kids always played ball. And there was a kid that came to our vacant lot all the time. And he had, back in those days, that was a long time ago, but he had a pair of black high-top canvas tennis shoes, but they were always only laced up halfway up, because what he did was, this kid was in the library of people who are impatient. He was way up on the top shelf. If he got a knot in his tennis shoes, this little kid, he just took out his pocket knife he carried in his pocket and cut the laces off. And so that's why he ended up only having three or four laces tied, instead of taking the time to untie the knot so it could be tied again. And that's what happens in relationships. Instead of taking the time to really untie the knots of broken relationships, it's easier for some of us just to cut them off, go on to the next person or go on to the next job or go on to the next thing. And we set a pattern in life doing it. So it's important to what I call never cut what you can untie, because that's the secret really of rebuilding in relationships, because they're four steps here. Timing is everything. And so when you're trying to conflict will destroy your team. It'll destroy your home. It'll destroy everything. So never cut what you can untie. There's a time to back off. Some of us don't realize that, but there's a time we need to back off, not just blaze in and blurt it out. There's also a time to stand up. You know, some people never do stand up, so people don't have respect for them. They just, the way they deal with conflict, they just back off all the time. Some of our hearers may be like that. And they think just by backing off, it's going to solve it, and it never does. So there's a time we have to stand up. Thirdly, there's a time we have to give in. You know, when we were raising our daughters, it was always more important to me to lose a few little battles to win the bigger war, and to give in on a few non-essentials and not just keep my thumb on them constantly. And then fourthly, there's not only time to stand up, to back off and stand up and give in, there's a time to reach out. And that's what Nehemiah was really doing in rebuilding. And if you really think about it, we were in conflict with God. I mean, we've all sinned and come short of the glory of God. We've all gone on our own way. And Christ came to bring us back into relationship with God, to restore that lost heritage we lost in the garden when our first parents sinned and fell short of the glory of God and were cast out of the garden. We've been trying to get back to that relationship forever. And so we couldn't do it on our own help. And we couldn't do it on our own strength. So Christ came to take God the Father by one hand and us by the other and to reconcile us to God and to bring us to God. So what did he do and how did he do it? Just exactly like we're talking about here in Nehemiah. First thing he did, he backed off. He was going to resolve this conflict. First thing he did, he backed off. See him in Gethsemane's garden. He backed off under those olive trees alone, taking in so he could give out. That's where he won the battle of Calvary, really, when he backed off and Gethsemane. Then see him stand up. He stood up before Caiaphas, the high priest, and Annas, and Pontius Pilate. And he stood before them. They said, "Are you the Messiah?" He said, "It's as you've said." He stood up to them. And then he gave in. Nobody pushed and shoved our Lord up the Via Dolorosa to the cross. He went willingly as a lamb to the slaughter, and he gave in. And then we see him on the cross with arms outstretched, reaching out, saying, "Whosoever will may come." And through that, he restored that relationship with us. So if there's a broken relationship in your home, at the office with somebody, on your athletic team, wherever it is, conflict will tear your team apart. So just remember there's a time to back off, a time to stand up, a time to give in, a time to reach out. And we deal with that in great detail in this book.
I want to encourage you all to pick up a copy of your own book, The Nehemiah Code. It's never too late for a new beginning. This is a great book, too, for those who are headed off to college, maybe in a new marriage, getting their first real job out there. I would say, since it does benefit Mission Dignity, buy not just one copy, but two or three and gift them. Have them available so you can just say, "Hey, if you need hope, here, hand it to a stranger." What a beautiful gift. Nehemiah left us a gorgeous story, and for you to bring it all together is incredible.
Thank you, Christiane. And you know, that's been the secret of the entire Code series, because people have bought them and then they've given them as gifts. In fact, I got an email on my website, oshawkins.com, from a lady on the East Coast just last week. It was her birthday, and she had 15 friends in her Bible study, and she said, "You know, instead of wondering what I was going to get for my birthday, I bought 15 copies of the Joshua Code and gave them to everybody in our Bible study." So that's the way it happens. And, you know, there's a men's Bible study at a church here in Dallas that just have ordered 1,000 of the Nehemiah Codes to give to all the men in that Bible study to take them through that for the next 6 weeks. So God is blessing in an incredible way. And I think one of the reasons, to be honest with you, not to be pious, but I think one of the reasons God blesses these books is because not only do they help us grow in Christ in a way we can put a handle on, they're very practical, but the fact that all the royalties go to support some good and godly people who've given their whole lives. You know, the book of James, I wrote a book also called The James Code, which is a practical book about putting our faith into action. But there's a passage in James that says, "Pure and undefiled religion is this, to take care of widows and orphans." And so every time somebody buys one of these Code Series books, they're supporting one of these precious pastors' widows out there that are in real financial need.
But we'll be sure to have all those links in the show notes so the listeners and the viewers can readily access it, because I know they're going to want to pick up a copy. I have to ask you, Dr. Hawkins, when you were writing the Nehemiah Code, what was the greatest lesson God taught you personally?
Well, you know, actually, Christiane, basically is what I was just talking about that conflict resolution. This book really came out of an interesting thing. Mike Ditka, who was a Hall of Fame professional football player.
Go Bears!
He won the Super Bowl when he was coaching the Bears. Good for you. You know that. You know your stuff, girl. Well, and he was, years ago, he was a coach of the New Orleans Saints. And Mike is a very good friend of mine. And he was rebuilding the football program in the Saints. And so he asked me to come down for a period of weekends at their home games and stay with the team in the hotel and be on the sidelines with them and do a motivational deal with them on Saturday evenings before the game on Sunday. So actually, these six chapters came out of the six motivational messages that I gave to the New Orleans Saints back in when he was rebuilding the New Orleans Saints. And I just took them and applied them with the book of Nehemiah to get some biblical background and put them in a way where they could be applicable to all of our lives, no matter who we are, no matter whether we're trying to rebuild our self-confidence or whether we're just rebuilding our life or getting out there, like you said, just getting started in our first job or going to college or rebuilding a marriage or trying to recover and restore a marriage or a business. A lot of businesses, actually, on August 28th is when it'll actually be released. There have already been over 40,000 pre-orders of that book, of the Nehemiah Code. So there are a lot of people, a lot of businesses are buying it for their leadership teams and stuff like that. So we're really encouraged by that.
Oh, that is awesome. And speaking of football, I love football, but we're not going to talk about it. I'm just going to leave a teaser. You mentioned in your book that, and you talk about being knocked down, and you talk about John Madden, former professional football coach and TV analyst. A lot of us recognize that name, but he uses a term yak. Now, do you want to expand on that?
No, that's a good one. I'll expand on it. Madden actually coined the phrase when he was a color commentator on the NFL sports and when he was doing football games. Yak stands for an acronym that means yards after contact. And what it does, it studies like a running back, and from the time he's hit by a tackler, how many yards he makes after he's come into contact with an opposing player and has been touched or hit. So it's the yards after contact, and that's really what matters in life. It's when we get hit and we get knocked down that we don't just lay there, crumble ourselves on the ball, that we keep our legs moving, that we keep moving forward, keep moving toward the goal. And so that whole chapter there in Nehemiah is about how to overcome our obstacles, how to not get knocked down, but how to, when we get hit, to keep going, because in life, not just in football, it's the yak that really matters in life. And too many marriages were left too early because when somebody got hit, they just crumbled and they didn't keep trying to move forward. And so I just believe it's never too late for a new beginning, because all of us, in fact, every day we have a new beginning, and it's never too late to begin one. Maybe some of your hearers right now that are having a really difficult time, thinking that maybe God's through with them, or maybe they're just don't have any more future left, but they do, because it's never too late for a new beginning. Anybody can get up and get going if they really put their faith and trust in Christ.
Amen. It's time to rebuild. There's always room for a fresh start when it comes to Jesus Christ.
Amen. I was reading this morning. It says his mercies are new every morning.
Praise the Lord for that.
Yeah.
Well, I know people are going to want to get in touch with you, Dr. Hawkins. So where can they find you?
Yeah, best way to do it is just go to oshawkins.com. There are hundreds of free resources there. My wife, Susie, has a click on Susie there. You'll see a lot of her blogs. She's got a book out on to ministers' wives. She also does ladies' Bible studies all of her life, and she's got some great ladies' resources on our website. There are hundreds of free resources. There are a lot of free book downloads on there also. Plus, there's ways to purchase the code series there. So there's just a lot of great Christian resources at oshawkins.com, and you can email me through that, and I'll see it.
Fabulous. Well, we will have all the links in the show notes for you. But before I let you go, Dr. Hawkins, I have one last question.
I think something's coming here.
The series is called My Strength is My Story. What has your story gifted you?
It gifts me every day, but it gives me, one thing I would say is that it's gifted me with the truth and the reality that life is about relationships. And Christiane, you only have three relationships in life. And every one of your listeners right now only has three relationships in life. There's an outward expression. That's a relationship we have with each other. At home, at the office, right now, or in the social arena. You know, at the end of every great creative act, God spoke.
And he said, that's good. He made the sea and land. He said, that's good. He divided the sea and land. He said, that's good. He made the plant life. He said, that's good. He made the, put the stars in space. He said, that's good. He made the animal life. He said, that's good. He made man. And he said something else. Not good. He said, this isn't good. He said, what? It's not good for man to be alone. We're made to connect with each other in this outward expression of these interpersonal relationships. Secondly, we have an inward relationship. That's a relationship we have with ourselves. Call it self-worth, self-respect. I got up this morning and shaved. You got up this morning and put on makeup. You looked at yourself in the mirror. We live with ourselves. And you know what? Most of the things that go wrong in my outward relationships with Susie or anyone else are really just what's going on inside me. I get mad at the office. I go home and I project it out on her. But there's one other relationship, not just outward, not just inward. This is what separates us from all the other creative order. We have the capacity to enter into an upward relationship with God through Jesus Christ and know Him in the intimacy of father and child. Here's the bottom line. I'm through. We're never going to be properly related to each other until we're properly related to ourselves. And that'll never happen until we discover or rediscover how indescribably valuable we are to God, that nobody has a DNA like you. And we come into a relationship with God through Jesus Christ and find our self-worth in Christ. That's what Paul said, Christ in me, the hope of glory, and then share that love of Christ with others. So in answer to your question, it's a long answer, but life's about relationships.
You share part of that in your book, The Nehemiah Code. I cannot wait for everybody to pick up a copy. Dr. Hawkins, it has been an honor and a pleasure to have you on. And I just want to continue to remind people, it's never too late for a new beginning.
Amen. Thank you, Christine.
Feeling inspired, ready to train for life and love your journey? Visit createyournow.com for more incredible resources to help you along the way. We'll see you next time on Create Your Now, Your Best Selfie. And remember, always be sure you consult your physician before beginning any health and fitness plan.